The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, I'd appreciate short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its nursery recruitment targets.
Minister Claire Hawhey.
The Scottish Government does not set targets for early learning and childcare ELC workforce recruitment.
Megan Gallagher.
In 2018, Nicola Sturgeon promised to recruit 435 additional graduates to nurseries to close the poverty-related attainment gap. 4 years later, this target has not been met. New figures show a quarter of posts are lying empty and over 100 nurseries in the most deprived areas are missing a teacher. Presiding Officer, this is yet another SNP education failure. So can I ask the Minister why this target has never been met? And why children in the most deprived areas have been left without a nursery teacher?
Minister.
So thank you, Presiding Officer. Since 2017, the early learning and childcare workforce has expanded significantly. Since the ELC workforce expansion began in 2017, the number of graduates working in ELC with degrees relevant to early years has increased by 52%. And this expansion means that by August 2021, every local authority in Scotland confirmed they were able to offer 1140 hours of funding ELC to all 3- and 4-year-olds and the 2-year-olds who need this. This is great for families and for children, and being able to access high-quality ELC delivered by a range of staff with different skills and qualifications is a cornerstone of narrowing the poverty-related attainment gap.
Megan Gallagher.
Presiding Officer, I am astounded that the Minister believes that the Scottish Government is doing a good job when our nursery sector is facing a staffing crisis. Nursery owners in the PVI sector have warned the Scottish Government that the expansion of free early learning childcare is under threat. Pay gaps between local authority and private settings of around £1.40 an hour is causing nursery staff to leave the sector. The Scottish Government cannot continue to ignore these serious concerns. So what measures will the Scottish Government implement to create equity between local authorities and the PVI sector, and how will they address the staffing crisis?
Minister.
So our collective focus throughout the 1140-hour expansion has been to improve conditions across the private, voluntary and child mining workforce with regard to funded ELC. When ELC expansion began, local authorities were already paying above the living wage to their staff, and the funding settlement reflects this. By contrast, our research indicates that around 80% of staff delivering funded ELC in the private and third sectors were paid less than the living wage at the time. We've seen real progress since, with our 2021 health check indicating that 88% of private providers intended to pay the real living wage to all of their staff by August 2021. Public funding and Scottish Government policy can only affect a certain amount of change, and ultimately business owners make their own decisions about their business models and salaries. However, that said, the Scottish Government has taken a range of actions to support the private and third sector through the 1140-hour early learning and childcare expansion programme, including to support the recruitment of highly qualified childcare staff. And we're taking a strategic approach to mapping out the workforce requirements to deliver our existing and new commitments, and taking forward a series of actions to support recruitment and retention across all parts of the childcare sector.
CoCab Stewart. My apologies, Ms Stewart. Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it's excellent news for families that children are being offered 1140 hours of early education and childcare. Can the Minister say how many children who were offered that 1140 hours have actually received it over the course of this year? Because I know of a number of nurseries who have had to move on to reduced hours to cope with staff absences because of a lack of resilience and staff shortages in the system.
Minister.
Of January 2022, over 111,000 children were benefiting from funded ELC. That's 97% of eligible children.
Pretty amazing.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to Megan Gallagher for highlighting the Scottish Liberal Democrat research on this. At the current rate of progress, it's going to take 10 years to achieve a one-year target. No wonder the attainment gap is getting wider. Thousands of nursery children have been and gone, and without the benefit of the extra teacher that they were promised by Nicola Sturgeon. Given that she has just abandoned that commitment made by Nicola Sturgeon in 2017, how should we believe any future commitment made by the First Minister in this chamber?
Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. I mean, teachers continue to have an important role to play as leaders and educators alongside other degree qualified ELC specialists supporting our youngest children on their learning journey. And research shows that the best experiences for children are provided where there's a range of staff with complementary skills and higher level qualifications. And we are proud of the continued growth in the number of degree qualified ELC staff and those working towards degree level qualifications. And since the ELC workforce expansion began in 2017, the number of graduates working in ELC with degrees relevant to early years has increased by 52%. So I hope Mr Cole-Hamilton will welcome those statistics.
Hear, hear.
Question number two, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government what immediate action it will take in light of recent reports that nearly £2 million in pupil equity funding has been spent on police officers in schools since 2018.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Decisions on how to use pupil equity funding are taken by head teachers in an empowered education system. We trust schools and head teachers to know their pupils best and to take decisions that are in the best interest of children and young people. The majority of the £634 million distributed in PEF to schools is invested in approaches to improve literacy, numeracy and health and wellbeing through the recruitment of additional teaching and support staff, family link workers and partnership with third sector organisations. Where there are projects involving Police Scotland in place, schools find them to be of great benefit. They are highly engaged in proactive and preventative work in communities with families, working alongside social work and third sector organisations. They are not policing in school. To be clear, the £2 million described is a very small proportion, just 0.3% of the pupil equity funding that has been distributed to schools across 32 councils since 1718.
Willie Rennie.
The Education Secretary does really need to cut the Slopey Shoulders Act, because the pupil equity funding operational guidance that I have read, and I'm sure she wrote, that encourages this kind of spending. It says consideration should be given to how the school can work with community partners beyond education. So this is her doing. The children's charity Abba Lauer, who made this discovery, want to know what the evidence is that policing in schools will help children's learning. So where is the evidence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, for the avoidance of any benefit of the doubt of Mr Rennie, they are not policing in schools. I made that very clear in my original answer. The schools know their learners best. They are responsible for using the pupil to equity funding to undertake approaches that they think will best support their pupils to achieve to their full potential. It is very important that we do look at how the money is spent. It is often spent on family link workers, for example, and in collaboration with those outside the school, including youth work and family learning, and on approaches to reducing the cost of the school day. But I will give one example, Presiding Officer, about how this money can be used and has been used in schools in Fife, where there has been school holiday programmes targeted at supporting vulnerable and at-risk children, anti-violence programmes and also transition programmes. The school itself shows an improved attendance rate, early intervention in supporting children and families to avoid limits and to avoid or limit criminal behaviours, and very much an improved community relations. That is what happens when schools work with partners right across the community, including, if they decide it's necessary and appropriate, with the police. And I think some of the examples of this show that this has been working, as shown by the head teachers' feedback themselves.
Willie Rennie.
She presented no evidence. There's no evidence that policing in schools will help close the poverty-related attainment gap by 2026, or whatever the policy is this week. Yet her operational guidance still encourages it. And what a slur on children from disadvantaged backgrounds. They have been branded by their government as criminals before they've even had their first lesson. It's the money that is supposed to follow
Members,
the child,
thank you.
Not the police.
Excuse
so will
me,
the Education Secretary
Mr.
revise
Rennie.
The operational guidance
Mr.
without
Rennie.
Delay?
Mr. Rennie,
I'm sorry, the levels of noise in the chamber are wholly unacceptable. I could not hear a word that Mr Rennie said there, and I'm sure nor could many others. Mr Rennie, please continue.
So, Presiding Officer, I'll say it again. They have been branded by their government as criminals before they've even had their first lesson. It's the money that's supposed to follow the child, not the police. So will the Education Secretary revise the operational guidance without delay to prevent vital funds for education being diverted to fund police in schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, unsurprisingly, that has drawn great criticism from across the chamber. Mr Rennie may criticise the Scottish Government. You may criticise the Scottish Government within the opposition parties, but actually what Mr Rennie has just said is not a slur on the Scottish Government, but on the head teachers who have chosen to use the pupil equity funding in this way. It's a slur on the teachers who have decided that they know their children best. And Mr Rennie once said to the Liberal Democrat conference, and it's not often I will quote a Liberal Democrat conference speech, but I will on this occasion, I want teachers to be at the centre of how we make Scottish education the best. I want to make sure that education is delivered by teachers, I presume is what Mr Rennie wanted in that quote. But exactly here, he's saying that actually no, teachers don't know best. Mm-hmm. Somehow he knows best without knowing any of the details of the projects involved. He's quite happy to come to this chamber and accuse teachers of making young people criminals. I hope he goes away and thinks seriously about that and not apologise to me, but apologise to the teachers who have put this in place and the pupils that they're there to serve.
I call Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From 30 years of experience as a teacher, I would like to celebrate the hard work of teachers and our young people in all their endeavours. And I know from very recent discussions with teachers and local police that staff are building relationships with the most vulnerable young people in our society, intervening early to build confidence, increase engagement with the curriculum, thereby increasing achievement. Whilst it's a shame that Mr Rennie appears to have forgotten the Lib Dems Conference 2020 commitment to put teachers in charge, will the Cabinet Secretary assure the Chamber that this government is committed to empowering teachers to use PEF funding to empower the teachers to use PEF funding to the best meet the needs of the young people in their schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think once again, Presiding Officer, you hear from Cocab Stewart an example of one of the projects where schools have been reaching out and working directly with the police. They have been shown through constant positive feedback from both staff and learners to have made a difference because young people have found that approach exceptionally useful. We have a range of projects where this can be used if teachers feel it is the right thing to do. And I think it's very important as Cabinet Secretary for Education that I don't just talk about empowerment, but I support empowerment in practice. It's a shame the Liberal Democrats, rather than doing that, have came here today to actually accuse teachers of not just inappropriate use of funds, but to make young people criminals, I think, is a sad and sorry state, even for Mr Rennie.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We heard Education Committee that equity funding was being used to plug gaps in the budget. Little did we realise that it was the policing budget too. Yeah. Will the Cabinet Secretary take this opportunity to say this practice is wrong? It might be, in her view, a small amount of money, but every penny going into education should be focused on teaching and learning. Can she not even agree with that?
Cabinet Secretary.
What the committee heard was a number of directors of education come to the committee and state in questioning that the pupil equity funding was additional funding, and it was that additionality that they found important. That evidence is there on the record from the directors of education. There is an absolute support within the teaching profession for the use of pupil equity funding. They feel that is an important part of the empowered system that we have. This government is committed to an empowered education system. It's unfortunate, it seems, that the opposition parties are not.